Good morning, students. In the last part, we have seen about the introduction of the internet protocol and the network protocol and the various types of network, that intranet, internet, and extranet. And in this part, we will start with the next topic called the mobile networks. We know that the mobile is a device which is connected with the help of this wireless technology. So the mobile network is made up of large signal areas called cells. Each cell is identified as a signal area. So those signals, that means those cells, join to form a large coverage area. So this signal area is directly proportional to the number of users in a particular region. The more the number of users, the more signal areas will be formed. Once the signal areas, more the signal areas are formed, it covers a large area. It covers a huge wider area. And each cell will have a base station. The base station will send and receive the mobile signals. It has the capacity to send and receive the mobile signals from one area to the coverage area to the next coverage area. And the mobile network assigns to the technology which has the capability or the capacity to send or receive the data or voice through a radio wave frequency or wireless technology. So this mobile network is assigned to the technology, is assigned to the technology which has the capacity to send or receive the data or voice through the radio wave frequency or the wireless technology. And initially these radio waves capture or carry only the voice, initially in those days. Later in the development, they carry both voice and data with the help of the network. With the help of the network, they have the capacity to carry both voice and data. So this is all about the introduction of the mobile network. Next, let us see about the generations of mobile networks. Next, we are going to see about the generations of mobile networks. So the first generation begins at 1981 by launching the NMT. NMT is nothing but Nordic Mobile Telephone Communication. So it means that they use only analog transmission. And in this analog transmission, only one call can be made at a time per radio channel. So and poor voice quality was there, and the transmission was unencrypted. With this unencryption, spoofing of identities occurred. It means that they misuse the identities. That is, they change the identities and misuse the identities. That is the spoofing of identities. To overcome all these disadvantages, the second generation was developed in the year 1991 with the GSM launch. GSM is nothing but Global System for Mobile Communication. Globally, they want to develop the system. So they used the digital transmission, and the transmission used various technologies, that is SIM, that is Subscriber Identity Module. They developed a specific identity for each subscriber. And the TDMA is nothing but time division multiple access. Based on the time, the multiple access has been can be done, and based on the code also, the division can be occur. Multiple access can be occur. That is CDMA. And last one is the transmission was fully encrypted, so no illegal or access or misuse can be done with the transmission. And in the second to third generation, in the year 2000, they developed GPRS launch, that is General Packet Radio Service. So it means that the packets are transferred with the help of the radio waves, that is the General Packet Radio Service. And with the help of this, they can able to send, receive messages, picture messages and emails, all multimedia messages can be shared. The speed initially was 115 kbps kilobyte per second, and maximum to the 384 kbps per second. And they use the technology called Edge. In your mobile phone, if you are using the 3G or 2G SIM, while turning off the internet, it shows a symbol called E at the top. So that is the edge technology. That is the edge, that is enhanced data rate for global evolution. And the next is the third generation, that is which was developed in 2003, and it is the first UK 3G launch. The first UK, they have launched the first 3G service, and it has a higher frequency band. The second to third generation, we have seen that the CDMA will have a 384 kbps per second the data rate, and they have increased here is up to 2 mbps per second the core division multiple access, and some company uses the extension, that is WCDMA, that is wideband CDMA, the wideband core division multiple access they have used, and that is 384 kbps to, that is 2048 kbps, that is 2 mbps per second. And some company uses the ATM technology, that is asynchronous transfer mode. Say for example, if one after completion of one data, the other data doesn't start. Simultaneously, it starts multiple data transfer. That is the irrespective with the time, the transfer mode happens. And the last one is the all these things are handled by the an European standard, that is UMTS, that is Universal Mobile Telecommunication System. Based on this standard, all the third generation features have been developed. And next one is the fourth generation. It was developed in 2007. It is the ad hoc network model. Ad hoc network model means it's nothing but ad hoc is nothing but they doesn't have any fixed infrastructure. Based on the current situation, they develop or they create a new network model. So that is based on the current situation or current scenario or current existing scenario, they develop a network model, that is the ad hoc network model. They used IP, that is internet protocol, for each mobile devices. In this IP, with the help of this IP, all these functionalities can be achieved, that is WLAN, the GPRS, and European standard, all these come under the fourth generation. And the data rate has been increased to 2 Mbps to 10 Mbps. And the last one is the expecting generation, is the fifth generation. This high data rate and the reduced latency and the cost reduction. This high cost reduction and the, with the huge capacity. And it has two phases, Release 15 and Release 16. So they have separated the pilot phase as in the Release 15 and the and next phase as the Release 16. And the speed may go up to the extent to 20 Gbps per second. And this was the estimation of 15 to 50% more than the fourth generation of the speed. So this is all about the generation of mobile network. Next, we will see about the wireless LAN, that is WLAN.
Next, we are going to see about the WLANs 802.11. So WLAN stands for Wireless Local Area Network System, and 802.11 stands for the technical code which is already predefined in the internet protocol. So there are various technical codes available for this wireless local area network. The technical code represents as 802.11. So we all know that Wi-Fi stands for wireless fidelity. So the main aim of the Wi-Fi is to provide the connectivity to the computers and the other alternative devices to be connected with the local area network or to the internet without the help of wires and cables. So this Wi-Fi can also be called as the WLAN, that is wireless local area network. So you can able to see the image, the center, there is a device which sends and receives the signals. By surrounding, the other devices are get connected to the Wi-Fi without the help of the wires and cables. Next, we will see about the advantages of Wi-Fi, that is the benefits of Wi-Fi. It provides mobility. For example, I can able to get the internet connection wherever I carry my device, either at home or at work. So This is only possible with the help of the Wi-Fi technology. I can able to get easily connected with my device to the internet wherever I travel only with the help of this Wi-Fi technology. And it provides connection to the internet. And the flexibility of LAN, the local area network, is more flexible when the devices are connected through wireless and ensures the connectivity of the internet connection. And also, even in the remote place where you cannot able to get connected with the internet, with the help of this Wi-Fi, it is possible to get connected even in the remote place also. And it is very low cost and it has more benefits when compared to the wired network. So this is all about the WLANs 802.11. Next, we are going to see about RFID. So RFID stands for radio frequency identification. So it means that it is going to identify some information with the help of the radio waves frequency. So that is the exact meaning. So RFID uses radio frequency wireless technology to identify the information that are stored in the object. So RFID is mainly used for the radio waves to read and capture the information that are stored on a tag. So here the tag, we can say it as a, in other words, a chip where it stores some information about the object. So the tag can be read from several feet away. Similarly, a barcode reader or a QR code scanner, like that. The tag can be read from several feet away and does not need to be in direct line of sight of the reader to be tracked. It means that, say for example, it is a similar example is QR code scanner. The QR code can be scanned. It doesn't require the QR code to be scanned in the direct line of sight. We can have the scanner in any position to scan the QR code, whether even it is upside down or is a little bit crossed. So it scans the information. Similarly, this tag can be read from several feet away and does not need to be in direct line of sight of the reader for tracking. So this RFID is made up of two parts. That is, first one is a reader and another one is a tag. So this reader, which is similar to the barcode scanner, which will also look similar to the barcode scanner, and a tag, or a, we can call it as a label. So where the datas are stored about the object. So this RFID tags are installed with the transmitter and the receiver. This tag will have two parts, that is transmitter and the receiver. So the transmitter transmits the signal and the receiver receives the signal. So the RFID component on the tags has two parts. The tag is further divided into two parts. We have already told that it has a transmitter and the receiver, whereas these two parts are a microchip which stores the information and process the information, and the antenna to receive the signal and to transmit the signal. So the receiver and the transmitter will come under the antenna. So this tag replies the information from its memory bank. Memory bank is nothing but a small memory storage will be there where the data is stored about the basic identification information about the particular object. So it works the similar operation of the barcode or QR code reader. There are two types of RFID tags available. So first one is the active RFID and the passive RFID. So the passive RFID means, so it uses the reader radio wave energy. So it doesn't have any inbuilt power supply or inbuilt battery. So it uses the reader's radio wave energy to read the stored information and to send back to the reader. Whereas in the active RFID, it can also be called as battery powered RFID. So this tag is installed with a small battery in it. So from there, it consumes the power to broadcast the information. So this is the difference between the passive RFID and the active RFID tag. So next we will see about the main components of RFID system. Main components of a RFID system. So the RFID system has three main components: the tag, reader and the controller. So we have already told that the tag, which is nothing but a microchip, a silicon chip, so which is attached to a small antenna which receives the signals and transmits the signals, and this tag is mounted on a flat surface that we call it as a substrate. So you can able to see the image, the chip is connected with the tag and the antenna coil is surrounded to the chip, and all these things are mounted on a substrate, flat surface. So next one is a reader. So the reader has an inbuilt scanner with the antennas for transmitting and receiving the signals, which is mainly used for communication to transfer the information that is stored in the object, that is stored in the tag which is attached to the object. So it looks similar to the barcode reader or QR code scanner. And the last one is a controller. So controller is nothing but the host computer where the reader is connected with the computer, and the where in the computer the microprocessor receives the reader's input and process the data with the help of the computer. So RFID system is further classified into two types, similar to the RFID tag. Both are more related to each other. The RFID systems are active and passive, and the active RFID system in which the tag has its own power source, which is similar to the active RFID tag, that is a battery powered RFID tag. So this tag will have its own power source, and it is mainly used for larger distance to track, to scan or to read the data at a larger distance, and to track high value goods like vehicle. The tag will be attached to the vehicle, and the based on that the vehicle will be tracked. And next one is a passive RFID system. The tag gets the power through the power from both antenna in the reader and also the tag antenna. So it gets the power from the radio wave energy from both the reader antenna and the tag antenna. So they are mainly used for shorter distance, shorter range distance to scan the tag. And next we will see about the reference model. What are all the reference model that are used in the network protocols? Reference model. So first one is the OSI model. So OSI stands for Open System Interconnection Model. So it gives the general framework, that is a general outline, how the network protocols to be enabled along with the software and how the system to be developed based on the general guidelines. And also it describes the standards specification for the intercomputer communication, how the computer to be gets communicated. And it has various layers, various level of layers. Let us see one by one. So first one is the physical layer. So physical layer, it defines, it tells how the device should be, how the device, both electrical and physical specification for the devices. And the next one is a data link layer. The second layer is the data link layer. So it confirms the data transmission, whether the data is transmitted with the free of errors. And it confirms, it guarantees the data transmission. So this layer has some protocols, some basic protocols, like we told that 802.11 for Wi-Fi, that is WLAN. And similarly 802.3 for Ethernet. Like this, it has some simple protocols. And the next one is a network layer. So it is a third layer which confirms, which determines the path of the data packets, how the data to be transferred from where to where, on which path the data to be transferred. So at this layer, routing of data packets is found using the IP address. With the help of the IP address, the data is transferred and the data path is confirmed. So now let us see the fourth layer, that is the transport layer. So it is the fourth layer which guarantees, which confirms the transportation, or that is the sending and receiving of data, whether it is successful or not, whether any interruption has been occurred, or whether the data is transferred successfully. Like that, all the confirmation will be given in the transport layer. It also includes the error checking operation, whether any interruption has been made, what type of interruption was that, and all these things will be mentioned in the transport layer. And the fifth layer is the session layer. So it identifies the established system session. Session is nothing but from starting a group of data packets is combined into a session. From there, how the session is completed or not, whether any interruption in between the session has been occurred, like that, all these things will be mentioned in the session layer. It also it identifies the established system session between the different network entities. So from one network to the other network, if a session is transferring, so whether the session is completed successfully or not. It also controls the dialogues between the transmission. Dialogues is nothing but the transmission, the instruction between the computers. So for example, while accessing a system remotely in the sense I am accessing a system far away with the help of the internet, a session is created, a duration is created between the two computers through the remote system. So that duration we call it as a session here. Next one is the presentation layer. So it is the sixth layer that does the translation of data to the next layer. So presentation, it gives the presentation to the data for application to the next layer. That is the next layer is the last layer, is the application layer. For application layer, before going into the application layer, it gives a presentation, it gives a translation of the data. So encryption, decryption, all these things will be done in the presentation layer. And also the secure socket layer, that is a secure layer will be applied for the data transmission. All these things will be done in the presentation layer. So, and then a last one is the application layer. So it is the seventh layer, that is the last layer, which acts as a user interface platform, which consists of the software within the system. It acts as a user interface for communicating with the software. The user can easily communicate with the software with the help of this application layer. So this is all about the OSI model, that is Open System Interconnection Model. So here you can able to see the OSI layers with the various types of protocols for each and every layer, how the layers are get segregated or categorized with the hardware and software. So first two layers comes under the hardware. We told that the physical and the data link, and the remaining layers will belongs to the software. And here the datagrams, data packets, the data, how the data is represented in a specific term for each and every layer. Like that, they have given in the right, the third column. So in the physical layer, it is represented as a bit, whereas in the data link, it is converted as a frame, and when transferred to the software, it transfer as a packet. The data are grouped into a packet, and in the transport layer, it is converted into a segment, and the last in the session, presentation, and application layer, it is converted as a upper layer data. So in the center column, you can able to see the various transmission control protocol and internet protocols, what are all the protocols used in each and every layer. The next reference model is the TCP/IP model, that is transmission control protocol, internet protocol. So these two protocols is a set of protocols which mainly governs the communication among all the computers on the internet. So that is why the transmission control protocol, it controls the transmission, data transmission. So it has a predefined set of instruction to for controlling the data transmission. So it tells how the information, that is how the data should be packed, how the data to be grouped, and how it is to be sent and received, where to be sent, where and how to be received, as well as it tells how the data to reach its destination. All these details will be predefined in a set of instruction, and that comes under the TCP/IP. So TCP/IP is a combination of two protocols, that is transmission control protocol and the internet protocol. So the internet protocol mainly specifies the logistics of the packets, that is transformation. Logistics is nothing but transformation from one source to another, that is transformation of the data packets from source to destination that are sent out over the networks. It specifies the packets which have to go and where to go and how to get there, how to reach the destination. So all these things will be defined in the internet protocol. So the transmission control protocol guarantees the trustworthy transmission of data. So whether the data is successfully transmitted or not, whether any interruption has occurred, all these things will be given by the transmission control protocol. So it sees that the packets for errors and submits the request for retransmission in case of any of them are missing, any of the packets are missing. So all these things will be done by the transmission control protocol, that is TCP. So there are various protocols, the frequent protocols, the TCP/IP protocols are there. The first one is a HTTP, that is a hypertext transfer protocol. So hypertext we have already seen in the class 11. That is the text which has a embed link in that, a hypertext transfer protocol. It is a dynamic text, and it is mainly used to between a web client and a web server, and it guarantees the non-secure data transmission. So that is the main thing. Non-secure data transmission is given by the HTTP. In later, they have developed a secured data transmission, that is HTTPS, hypertext transfer protocol secured. It is mainly used between the web client and the web server and ensures secure data transmission. So all the data transmission are secured. It ensures the security level for the data transmission. And the next one is the file transfer protocol, FTP. So it is mainly used between the computers for sending and receiving the files. Say for example, the Google Drive. Like that, all the wherever the data is transferred from one source to another comes under the file transfer protocol. It just mainly used for sending and receiving the file. And next we will see the layers. What are all the layers available in the TCP/IP? So there are four layers available, that is network access layer, internet layer, transport layer, and the application layer. So the network access layer mainly concerned with the building packets, that is data packets. And next one is the internet layer. It describes how the packets are to be delivered, so how the data to be transferred. And the transport layer ensures the proper transmission of the data. It confirms the data transmission, successful data transmission. And the last one is the application layer. So application mainly it processes the network, and all the protocols will come under this application layer. The what we have seen, that HTTP, HTTPS, FTP, and also SMTP, that is simple mail transfer protocol for transferring through email. All these comes under the application layer. Here you can able to see the diagram for the TCP/IP layer. So it is a 32-bit data. So how the data is separated? So from 0 to 4, it represents a version, and 4 to 8, it represents the length of the data, and 8 to 16 bits, it represents the types of service. And after that 16 to 31 only, it the total length of the data. So in the left vertically it is written, it is separated the TCP, how far the TCP protocol works, and how far the IPv4, that is a version 4 internet protocol works. All these things are separated. So you can able to see the source port and the destination port, it is separated, and a sequence number, and also the acknowledgement number is given in the transmission control protocol. It confirms whether the transmission is successful or not. And in the internet protocol version 4, you can able to see the various separation of the 32 bits. So identification and the protocol types of service, what types of service it comes under, and the total length of the data. All these things you can able to see. You can able to see the source address and the destination address. It is mentioned. So based on that, the data will be transmitted. So this is all about the TCP/IP model. Next, we are going to see about the four layers of TCP/IP protocols in detail. So first one is the network interface layer. So it is the bottommost layer, and it is compared to the physical and data link layer of the OSI model. And different TCP/IP protocols are used in this layer, like Ethernet, token ring. Token ring is nothing but it holds the address of the next network for secure transmission, and frame relay, X.25. All these protocols are used in the, and ATM for wide area network. All these protocols are used in this layer, network interface layer. And this layer is assumed as an unreliable layer. So the reason for assuming it as an unreliable layer is it doesn't guarantee the successful transmission of the data. Only the transport layer guarantees for the successful transmission of the data. Other than the transport layer, no layers will give guarantee for the successful transmission of the data. So that is why it is assumed as an unreliable layer. And the next one is the network layer. Second layer is a network layer. So it is a layer where the data is addressed, packed, and routed among networks. And the protocols that are used in this network layer are IP, that is internet protocol, where it is the routable protocol which uses the IP address to deliver the packets. So it is also an unreliable protocol because it does not guarantee any delivery of the information. And the next protocol is ARP, that is address resolution protocol. It resolves the IP address, because for remembering the IP address is quite difficult. So it resolves the IP address to a MAC address, that is medium access control. A MAC address is a hardware identification number which has a unique identification for each and every device in the network. So that is, it is easy to map the IP network address to the hardware address. So that is the main aim of the address resolution protocol, ARP. And next one is the ICMP, Internet Control Message Protocol. It controls, it is mainly used by the network devices to send error messages and operational informations. Say for example, a computer or a router might not be reached, or a requested service is not presented. All these error messages will be sent with the help of this ICMP, Internet Control Message Protocol. And the IGMP, that is Internet Group Management Protocol. So it is a communication protocol used by the computers and the routers to send multicast, that is group communication messages, to the multiple IP address at once, at a time. In a single time, it can able to send multicast messages to multiple IP address. The computers and the routers will use this IGMP, that is Internet Group Management Protocol. And the next layer is the transport layer. The sessions are recognized, and the data packets are interconnected or swapped between the host, between the computers in this layer only. The two main protocols used here in this layer is TCP, that is Transmission Control Protocol. It provides a reliable connection-oriented transmission between the two computers, that is two hosts. It also ensures the delivery of the packets between the host. And the next protocol used here is user datagram protocol. And here this protocol provides the connectionless, unreliable, that is one-to-one or one-to-many delivery. All these information will be provided by the user datagram protocol. And the last layer of the TCP/IP protocol is the application layer. So the application layer is similar to the session, presentation, and the application layer of the OSI model. So all these three in the OSI model is compared to a single layer, that is application layer in the TCP/IP. And the protocols that are used here is HTTP, that is Hypertext Transfer Protocol, the core protocol for the World Wide Web, and the file transfer protocol, which enables the client to send and receive the files from the server, and a telnet, telephone network, and which is connected to another computer on the internet, and the simple mail transfer protocol, that is SMTP, mainly provides email services. And the last one is the domain name system. It refers to the host computers by using the names rather than the numbers. It just represents the host computer with a name rather by representing it as a numbers for easy understanding. So this is all about the TCP/IP model. And with this, the chapter 11 gets completed. So next we will start with the new chapter, that is chapter 12, in the next video. Thank you, students.